change going on. You can see the glass as half empty or half full, depending on whether you want to see it positively or negatively. Positively, I think there are many more people involved in technology today than at any time in the past. On the negative side, how much of that is spilling over into socially useful solutions? That's my question. Of course, the promise is huge. The promise is huge because if you have a group of this size, by the simple law of averages, even if 2 or 5% do something, it can potentially and it will shape society for a long time to come. Jonathan and Tanmay and all, especially people like Jonathan who are older than the students here, have been involved for a long time. But how do you get your work visible at a state, at a wider national, international level? It's not difficult. You can do it. Dream big and think big. So technology is changing. In those days there were small groups. I remember when I went to teach computers, the first lesson was how to switch on a computer. And I had to be careful that, you know, they waited till the UPS came on, the lights were fluctuating, and things have changed dramatically, but we are not looking positively at a change. Secondly, as you know, the older people will always tell you, in our times it was the golden era. You all guys know nothing. You all are going to ruin the world. That's what our parents also told us in the 60s. We don't know how we can trust you with the world, they said. And so when your elders tell you that, don't believe them. When they tell you that, you know, you have to be careful only about how much you earn and all, don't believe them. Go by where your heart takes you. I'm not saying everyone has to indulge in all these utopian dreams, but if some of you feel very strongly, this is my field, literacy is my field, no? Education is my field, or networking people is my field, or creating local content is my field, go and build your dream. So things are changing for the better. And the mere fact that we see so many people in a room like this, the mere fact that 91 Spring Board is there, the mere fact that we have so many tech groups here, is very positive. But at the same time, we should not become, you know, complacent and say, no, our problems are over, everyone has their own computer, so we don't need these groups, everyone knows GNU Linux, so we don't have to teach it. I don't think that's the right solution. Now you see the GITP, Go IT Professionals, some of them went to the village schools and they found that while the schools have computers, what is the state of those computers? Some of them are not working, some of them are in bad shape, because you see how it fits into the government's plan, that is a different issue. Government has given them money, when will they upgrade? So they are using things like, you know, your Raspberry Pi to teach children computing, especially in this lecture, Shura and things like that. The main problem I see it still is that we don't know, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. That is where groups like Google developers and others can, you know, build a network. And Tanmay has this vision of getting everyone together. I said, we should be putting down a book on what is happening in technology scene in Goa today. Otherwise it's so invisible. Everyone has their own experience. The first websites that Goa started in 1994, this year will be 25 years old. Yeah, so there was Goa.com, there was Goa World, and there was GoaNet. GoaNet is not a website, it's a mailing list, simple mailing list. And all these were started by students. So Goa.com was started by Malan Mazes.
He's working in AR.
Yeah.
Malan is currently working in AR in USA.
So he was a student at UIUC. They ran it here in Miramar out of his father's small flat. And, you know, then they grew big. But along the way, your model will have to change, because people were willing at one stage to pay 8,000-10,000 in those days, a lot of money, to set up a website. Then it became so simple to set up a website that model of, you know, earning from websites alone was not possible. So that changed. Then Goa World was there. People run out of steam. And, you know, consistency is very important. If you want to do some project, you have to be passionate, you have to be mad about it. People should laugh, you know, at how serious you are about it. Only then you can bring about change. Stallman, whose photo we saw last, he spends 8 hours a day in those times. I don't know now, I lost that. 8 hours a day just running a global movement of free software and sharing, replying to each and every email he gets over 8 hours every day. So that was his contribution. So each of you should have your own passion. You should decide, this is my field, this is what I want to change. And you know, many journalists tell me, they say, when we were young, you know, they laughed and they tell you, when we were young, they believed, we believed that we could change the world. I laugh back and tell them, I say, even now, with all my grey hair, lack of hair, I believe I can still change the world. May not be the whole world, maybe one tiny aspect of it, you can do it. Sorry.
Okay. So, I know you often talk about how you are not a techie, but you are always known for your work in cost and promoting for. So, the second question was from someone, I think, who knows about your technical background. So, they asked which field or technology currently, according to you, has a strong hold?
Which
technology currently has a strong
hold?
It can be false,
or
it can be even outside of
false. Wrong question to the wrong person. Okay, you know, when I used to follow technology more closely, every year there is a fashion of the year. And people swear that this is the best, you know, this is the best, after this nothing will come. Next year the fashion changes. It's like, you know, selling a particular product, so people are selling a product. What fascinates me about Fox is not that it's just a different technology, but it's a different way of doing things all together. Now, just to cut into Google Developer Group, I think you cannot deny that the idea of user groups have come from the cost world, have come from the techie world, by and large, where people share with each other whatever they have, share freely. Don't look at knowledge as a product which needs to be molded. You know, and this is where we had a big fight with Microsoft. So today when I go for these exhibitions, I get culture shock because Microsoft comes out with these slogans that Microsoft loves open source and all that, they come out with these slogans. But in those days, there was a big ideological dispute because it was Bill Gates who changed the way of how software was made. I suggest you read his open letter to hobbyists. He's written an open letter to hobbyists. It's on Wikipedia and everything. It's all over the place. And in that, he says that if you don't pay the writer of software, you are stealing food from his table. Partly true. But by saying that, he has changed the full definition of software and made it something which is not shareable, something which is only purchasable. If I buy a book, I can give that book to whomever I want. No one can ask me. I can give it to my daughter, I can give it to my friend, I can throw it in the sea. I can keep it on the road, I can, like, you know, here there are some books anyone can read. But with software, it's not like that. You cannot use it anywhere else except on that. But of course, it's changing now. Today, with your smartphones and all that, we've seen a drastic paradigm shift where people are not hardly asking you to pay for your, you know, for your apps and things like that. So I think that, I am very committed to the idea because it fits in very well to the idea of sharing. And not only sharing software, ideas should be shared. I think, you know, we set up a books project called War 1556, which tries to promote local books. We've done about 140 books. And we also encourage authors to share their own content. We've not been able to convince more than 4 or 5 authors to do it, out of 140, which is a very small ratio. But, you know, the idea is that we never keep the copyright of the authors. So the authors can keep it or they can put it in the public domain if they want, in the Creative Commons. The Wikipedia has grown so much only because it is so shareable and because it works on networks. Yeah.
You can talk about Wikipedia also.
So, I think, you know, for me, knowledge has to be shared in whatever form it's available. Whether it is code, whether it is information, whether it is seats, people's seats. This is the whole debate about, you know, VT and all that. Whether seats should be shareable, whether products can be shareable with one another. With different people. Now we are entering a bit of a complex ground because as long as it's physical, then if I share something with you, I do something. But if it's non-physical, if it's an idea, when I share it with you, I don't do anything. Of course, there are models where people have worked on, you know, free software, they have worked on free knowledge, and they've actually earned a living out of it. My freelancing model has worked only because I'm open freely to share. So I've got 62,000 photographs on Twitter, which anyone can download and use. for, you know, without payment for non-commercial purposes, when you pay money for commercial purposes, they can do it. So sharing also has its own business model. People will ask, how can you produce if you're not getting paid for it? That's the wrong question to ask. You do it and you see how it works. There are different studies which show what are the motivations why developers produce these software. Because intuitively, I mean, it's counterintuitive. It's logically very kind of something that shocks us. You produce and put it out for free, doesn't make sense. But that's a totally different debate. You can read up on it. Yeah.
So he's been very modest. He hasn't talked about how he has started the whole company Wikipedia movement.
See, you know, those who can do, those who can't teach, and those who can't even teach, they start like a fire and they run away like me. So I'm great at that. So in 2006, you know, I realized that anyone can suggest a new language for Wikipedia. There's some format and all that. So I suggested, and they kept it in incubation. And they started a site on incubation. Now nothing was happening till 2012, 2013, 2014 or somewhere that thereabouts. Then the Center for Internet and Society, CIS, which is a Bangalore-based group, they are an NGO and funded and all that. So they came and decided that company something should happen on it. So they held a lot of workshops and then they got the students involved at Goa University, the company department and many others. There are still problems, no? We are not getting that connection between the techies and the language. As I was saying, so there is still a problem. Then in 2017, I went for one of the Wikipedia workshops. They are very generous. No? If you have a record as a Wikipedia contributor, they will invite you for your, for their workshops and they give you a lot of, goodies or what should I say, hospitality and other things. So I went for three of the workshops, one in Bangalore, one in Chandigarh and one in Delhi. And in the second workshop I started thinking to myself that nothing is happening in our language, what a shame this is. So I said, how do I solve this? I don't understand what, where we are going wrong, but I know something is going wrong. So I started a WhatsApp group and I said, instead of calling it a Konkani Wikipedia, let's call it a Goa group. So any language is okay as long as it's Goa related content. Whether it's Kokni, Marathi, English, Hindi, Portuguese, French, doesn't matter. Because I'm saying language as a tool looks beware. I will not come against you and say I don't like you because you're wearing a black shirt. At the end of the day, I should be interested in you as a person, not in your clothes. So then a lot of youngsters came together, including Tanmay and many other persons, and today we have someone in GEC who's talking to the Wikipedia and saying we want to be, they are actually doing some graphic work, their coding and all that for the Wikipedia. So I would suggest, look at all these technologies, you never know where you will find your passion and you will find a career also there. So there are n number of techies who are working at the level of Wikipedia, at the level of free and open source, all over the place. I must tell you the story of Sumi Devran, who we met up at some conference, you know how these things are in Bangalore. And he was talking about IT for the NGO sector, Microsoft and all that. So very conspiratorially, I met and whispered to him, I said, Sumi, why are you doing it in Microsoft? Look at Linux, look at free software and open source. 6 months later at the next conference, he was talking about free and open source completely, absolutely converted to the benefits of it. Then along the way, he managed to convince UNDP, which is the United Nations Development Program, to start a center in Thailand, called the IOSN, International Open Source Network, which was made to promote free and open source. Because rather than creating proprietary products, if you can create reusable products, so much better. So in that sense, I would really suggest to all, if you have even the slightest interest, spend 5% of your time looking at these solutions. It will give you the most satisfaction that you can derive from your full tech career.
Okay, so the last question.
Yeah.
So actually you might want to take a seat for this. So the last question is, how did you get into FOSS and technology in spite of being from an arts background? Now, and the reason that I feel that this is the most important question is, running a tech community, we always get feedback from people that, you know, how to get started into tech. They're interested, they're doing a degree in it, but they don't know what to, how to start, you know, working on projects, what kind of technology they should start learning. They do, basically, they just don't know where to start from, which is why I would like you to put this question in detail.
See, you know, two or three things. One is that...
So can tell your story also.
Yeah. I love reading. I understood the importance of knowledge in our life. Information. Not even knowledge. Information in our life. As a youngster. So according to me, whether it is computers or IT or the internet or journalism, you know, or publishing books, there is no big difference between all of these sectors. They have all something to do with information. You know, when you see the power of information, write an article, get it published in a newspaper, and see the way people respond to you and see how you feel. And then you tell me, okay, then you tell me whether you agree with me or not on this point. So, information is power, as the same thing. Information is power, we have to use it for a good purpose. Incidentally, if any of you all want to get started in writing, there are lots of opportunities, including open source, the magazine in Delhi, published by this EFI group and all that. So you know, writing should be part of your life. I'm sure many of you all are good readers, because techies are very curious people by nature. I'm sure there is hardly anyone here who has not been an avid reader as a child. Now, with life, we lose that interest in reading, and we don't get tired and all that. So, when I saw computers come my way, I said, this is fantastic. Of course, first we were just using it like a two-level typewriter. Internet came later along the way. But there was something called shareware in those days, shareware. Of course, the shareware was a very buggy thing. It didn't work. Because the moment you started liking it, you would say, pay $5, pay $10, you know, that kind of thing. But I thought it's a great idea. Like, if you could collect shareware and spread it around, you know, people would get access to this powerful tool. That was the first reason. The second reason was that my brother was in technology, and when he was young, he had this idea of starting a cooperative garage, you know, because he was also into mechanical, and he wanted to have a cooperative garage. But the pressure of technology when he got into the world of work was so high that they were struggling just to keep the machine going and to pay the salaries every month and things like that. So I said, like, you know, what struck me was that if people are so good at the technology, why can't they use it for their own purpose? So that was the second question. And thirdly, of course, it's closely connected with our work. Many journalists tend to be tech folks, but now less than earlier. So they understand that if you have access to technology, you can actually reach much further. If it was not for technology, I would have never been able to survive as a freelancer and go on. So not only survive, I've actually tried from 1994 onwards. And people told me, you're making a big mistake by leaving your full-time job. You never survive, you regret it, and you won't get your job back. But the fact is that never once have I got up and said, oh, it's so terrible being a freelancer. I've enjoyed it because of technology. So my suggestion is that people should deal with technology at a level which is benefiting them. So there's this guy in my village who runs a tractor. So I called him over. He is maybe an SSC pass. He has a problem with accessing the net. I told him, see, these are the seeds you can buy online. Can we find solutions for people in their own life where it affects them? With youngsters today, you have no problem. They see the computer as a toy. And then they go into programming, some of them will go into, you know, different aspects of it. How do we make it interesting and meaningful to their life? That's your challenge. I think I've thrown so much ideas to you all that, you know, you just need a break and a couple of copies to recover from. If you feel that you want to discuss anything with me, of course, welcome.